again. I've got a new tent to show you. It's the Nightcat Lanshan style tent. Let's check it out. So that's the tent pitched, ready to go. And that took me perhaps 4 or 5 minutes maximum, with a little bit of time for tweaking and adjusting and trying to get rid of the creases, that kind of thing. Right, so let's talk numbers, shall we? There's the critical stats about this tent. Weighs 934 grams, this one, like one of my scales at home. It's quite light for a one-man tent. The waterproofing on the fly sheet, the outer, the hydrostatic head is 5 meters, which is pretty good. And on the footprint, the tub, it's 6 meters, it's even better. Size-wise, well, it's quite spacious inside. The inner is a meter wide at its widest point and 80 centimeters at the head and the foot. The amount of head space depends on how you've got the pole set, but it's around the 120 centimeters mark. The length is about 2.3 meters, and that's plenty enough for the longest sleep pad, and also, you know, some space either side. But you're probably going to need that because of the way that the fly sheet slopes. Now, inevitably, trekking pole tents need a bit more space to set up than freestanding tents. So to use this effectively, you need an area that's about 5 meters by 5 meters to allow for the guy lines. It's a really compact tent when it's packed away. I mean, in this bag, it's very, very small, just a couple of liters, I suggest. More and more people are using trekking poles these days. There's lots of good reasons why. And so it makes very good sense to use that trekking pole as part of the support for the tent. That saves a lot of weight. But it does come with compromises as well, a bit more tricky to pitch. And by its nature, the design of the tent means that headroom isn't quite as generous as it is on more freestanding tents with curved poles. Now, this one comes in a fetching shade of green. You choose whether you like it or not. It does come in a more muted brown shade, but I personally would take either the green or the brown. I really like the stealthy nature of those kind of colours. I personally don't really care for the bright orange and red tents, which I think aren't very stealthy and aren't very respectful to other people that use in the hills. They do tend to stand out from a long way away. So either green or brown, you choose, they're both good. Now, when you're pitching this Lanshan style tent, then you need to be very mindful of the wind direction. The gap underneath the vestibule at the front is quite generous. It's sitting, I'd say, 20 centimeters off the ground at the moment, whereas the back and side of the tent, the clearance is just 4 or 5 centimeters. So that works very well if you've got the wind direction blowing from the back of the tent. If you have the wind coming towards the front of the tent, it's going to get underneath that vestibule and lift up and buffet you around a bit. It's going to be a nightmare. So I would always pitch it with the closed side facing into the wind. The other thing that's worth really pointing out with these tents is that the height that you set the pole at, the length of the pole, makes a massive difference to the success of the pitch. So this ground's quite soft, so the end of the pole is dug in a little bit. So I've got the pole set at about 1:28. Approximately, and that seems to be working very high with the tent. Any lower than that and the sides will be creased and baggy. If you set the pole any higher, then the inner tub is going to be lifted off the ground too much and it's not going to be a happy tent. So just for comparison, I've got the pole dropped down now to about 1:22, and I think that's about as low as you could go with this tent, because here at the sides they're very, very low to the ground, which is great for windy conditions. But any lower than this and you're not going to get any tension in the side, so it's going to get all flappy, and those flapping, rattling sides of the tent are going to keep you awake all night. So anything between 1:22 and 1:28, I think, is probably the sweet spot for this tent. One of the things that I don't really like about this style of tent, as it comes from the factory, is this ram's head clip that the vestibule gets attached to apply tension. Two reasons. Firstly, they are prone to breakage. The plastic can get a bit brittle with time. But secondly, they are incredibly fiddly to use. And if you've got cold fingers in gloves, it's going to be a nightmare. If you're inside the tent, reaching out to attach the ram's head is a knack that I've not yet mastered. It's a real pain. Now, I have said that I won't mention too much about modifications, but if you can possibly get rid of this factory arrangement, separate out the guy from the attachments for the vestibule, use some bungees, then it will make a massive difference to how easy this tent is to use. The cord from the bottom of the bathtub out to the peg has no adjustment on it at all. There's no cleat, it's a fixed length. The black strap from the fly does have a cleat on it, but that gives you a big problem when you're pitching. You know, when you're in rough country, you can't always put a peg where you want it, so some adjustability on that strap for the inner is kind of essential, and it's really strange that there isn't any. And also there's this offset between the length of that tie-up point from the inner and the black strap for the outer. The strap for the inner could really do with being twice as long. So that's a no-brainer to put right, in my humble opinion. So we've dealt with the dreaded ram's head clips and with the problems with the attachment of the inner bathtub to the pegs. Now let's have a look around inside the tent. Right, no tent review would be complete without the shot of lying down inside the tent. I'm about 5'10" on a good day, so pretty average height, I suppose. So I don't have a sleeping pad at the moment. I'm just lying on the ground, and so the amount of space above your head will be affected by how thick your sleep pad is. If you're using a closed cell foam mat, obviously won't make much difference, but a very thick winter pad, 5 or 6 centimeters thick, will be quite significant. Anyway, that being said, lying down here, got a sensible amount of clearance above my head. It's quite comfortable. And with this mesh inner, it feels quite spacious and airy. So you can see that the inner is completely mesh all the way down to the bathtub on all the sides. Fantastic ventilation on a warm evening. Today is an October day, it's quite breezy, and although it's quite sunny, it's there's a bit of chill in the air. And so one problem in the days like this is that the mesh does allow a breeze through, so it's going to be relatively cold. Talking of the width of the tent, well, you have it's a slightly odd shape. It's straight across the front, and then at the back there's this small sort of triangular section, so there's loads of space for clutter and all your stuff to go, as well as on top of your head and down by your feet as well. So there is a lot of space on the foot of the tent, but the design of it with the sloping roof means that the headroom is only at the very apex of the tent, and so it can feel a bit cramped because there isn't actually much space to move around inside. Its manufacturing quality is good. I've had a good old poke around and look at all the stitching. There are absolutely no loose threads. The stitching is top quality all the way through. So no complaints on the quality side as well. Right, so we need to talk about the door on this tent. And this is one thing that sets it apart from others of a similar design. This Nightcat tent only comes with, the only option is this three-season mesh inner. And the only option as well is the sort of J-shaped door. So it's a single zip going down and across. It's not a T-zip where there's a zip coming down and you have them going both two zips along the bottom. Now, this it really is to pay you money, take your choice. I have a J-zip on my Lanchan too, and I've learned to quite like it actually. I like the fact there's only one zip. It can be a bit more simple at times. There's a lot to be said for it. But on a tent that's quite small inside like this one, a T-zip can make a big difference because it enables you to open up the entire front of the inner of the tent, and it gives you much more sort of use. Now I also need to share with you, getting in and out of the inner, it's is an art, and I haven't really mastered it yet. There are several techniques, and none of them are elegant, and none of them are graceful. So you tend inevitably, when you're at the end of the day, you sit in the tent, you undo your boots or whatever. How do you get into the tent? Well, there are several ways. The first one is what I call the backwards roll. So this is it. I roll onto my back, lift my feet up past the pole, and then extend them again. And the other way is to kind of crawl in and then turn around in the tent. I guess you'll find your own way with experience, but it's not easy. Would it be any easier with a T-zip? Yes, it would, because I've tried this on my Lanshan one. If you have a T-zip, you can kind of crawl in one side of the pole and come round and have your head up the right way. So it's a bit easier. Is that clear? Another weakness I find with these tents, and it applies to all these trekking pole style tents, is that they only have one internal pocket, and it's a bit of a mean one as well. And it's only at one end of the tent, and sod's law means it's always at the wrong end when you pitch. So given the choice, I would ask them to put more bigger pockets around the tent, which would help a lot to keep yourself and your gear organized. But one thing you can say about these tents is that the vestibule is absolutely huge, massive. You can sit down in this quite comfortably out of the weather if you want to. So it makes a massive difference, the amount of space you've got available to you, and I really like this. So nice big vestibule, and although there's only one, there's plenty of space here for your rucksack, your boots, cooking space, that kind of thing. So it's very usable space underneath the vestibule, and that makes it much more practical, especially in weather that's not quite so pleasant. Okay, so now we've got to address the elephant in the room. What's the difference between this and the similar version from 3F Ultralight Gear? Bottom line is, not a lot. Apart from the logo on the fly sheet, the advertising is remarkably similar, and to my untrained eye, it really looks like they'd be both be made in the same factory by the same people. But the main differences are in the design. This Nightcat version is only available with a 3-season inner, and it's only available with a J-style zip. Okay, so that's the specification. What about the price? Well, this is where the main difference comes in. I think you can pick up one of these at the time of filming direct from Nightcat for about £111, which is incredibly good value given the quality of the tent and its lightweight usability. A very, very attractive proposition. The 3F version, where you can get it from a variety of sources, from Amazon, eBay, and there's a UK importer as well. And the prices vary from about £155 on Amazon to about £139 from the UK importer, Outdoor Gear Essentials. I personally would support the UK distributor because they give excellent service and they're very good for spares and such like advice. So the 3F version is a little bit more expensive than this, but the 3F version does have the option of a T-zip door. It also has the option of a 4-season inner. So is this tent a good solution for camping in the UK? I think so, but it depends when you're going to be camping. If you're going to be mostly in warmer weather, perhaps with the risk of condensation, then this is a fantastic solution. I personally much prefer tents with a separate inner, because of the reduction of problems of condensation. No matter what the tent is, what it's made from, if you're camping in a humid environment where it gets cool at night, condensation will happen. There's no getting away from it. So it's about finding a tent that helps to minimize the hassle from that. And this would be a great solution. The mesh inner will mean that you don't get too much condensation on the inside. And there's plenty of space and ventilation from this nice big vestibule as well. If you're going to be camping in less benign situations, where there's stronger wind, where there's heavier rain, when you need a bit more shelter, and where you've got more space in the tent, you need more space in the tent to fit your stuff, you've got a thicker sleep pad, you've got a thicker sleeping bag, that kind of thing, then this might not be quite so suitable. Right, so which one should you choose? Well, if you don't mind a J-shaped zip on the door, and if you're okay with only a three-season mesh inner, then the Nightcap version is definitely better value. If you're going to be using a tent in cooler, more windy conditions, where a solid inner would be a better bet, and if you really can't get on with a J-shaped door and you like the increased practicality and space that a T-shaped door gives you, then I'd suggest the 3F is a good thing to consider. Right, so that's my thoughts about this Nightcat tent. And you know, I really like it for the right time and application. It's unbeatable. It's light, it's compact, it's incredibly good value, quite versatile. So definitely a plus for summertime camping. I'll be lobbing it in my rucksack when I want to travel fast and light. I hope you found that useful. If you did, then subscribe to the channel and check out my other videos about Lanshan tents and how to modify them.